Hallelujah. Come on, my dear, and I see. Well, you can be seated. Let's have a good time in the place tonight. And let's just go ahead and be willing, everybody in the place, to go ahead and turn to God. There may be some things tonight that you begin to hear, and you recognize. Come on, that's good. You recognize that change has got to take place. And you're just going to have to be willing to do it. You recognize that there's a need, and you're going to have to be willing to turn to Father. You can't get stuck in a place. I want you to enjoy the presence of God. I don't want to have to begin to declare the things of God and look at a bunch of people sitting around the table not eating. Because then by the end of the meeting, it's just going to erode, and it's going to be like, what's going on now? What's wrong? But no one's taking a bite. So let's go ahead and eat. Let's go ahead and enjoy yourselves tonight and drink. Okay, then you can be happy and I can be happy and Father's going to be happy. He's going to stay happy, but he's going to be happy with us. Because I guarantee you right now, God's not happy with everybody. God takes no pleasure in the wicked. He takes no pleasure in rebellion. He takes no pleasure in disobedience. He takes no pleasure in us taking his gospel and holding it hostage and the glory in the name of his only begotten son and changing it into the image of men. He takes no pleasure in that. So we want to give ourselves here tonight to allowing God the Holy Ghost to redirect our lives and our spirit to where that you can be happy about the things that are coming out of my mouth by the Holy Ghost. I know you are, baby. I understand that. And I'm blessed by it. That's why I come stand by you a whole lot. And there's a couple of you, I just stand by the happy people. That's what God the Holy Ghost does. People say, why isn't the God the Holy Ghost around me very much? Because you're so sad. You're not willing to change. And he's just not going to hang out. He's not going to hang out there. People say, oh, well, I want God to come out and hang out with me. No, he's invited you to come hang out with him. People say, I want God to come down to earth with me. He said, no, you come up to heaven with me. And if you just can understand this, everything can begin to change in your life because everybody wants God to come and fix something he's already done with, and it's your doubt and unbelief that you're not receiving what he's already supplied. Hallelujah. 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 Ha ha. So tonight, I'm going to talk to you about the authority that God has given you as his children. And I don't want you to sit there and stare at me I want you to eat. I mean, if you can't do anything else, then pretend and take notes. Just do something. There's got to be some kind of an action. There has to be some kind of a response. If you do not respond to the Word of God in a way that the Word of God is deserving of, there is absolutely no way that you receive the impartation that God wants to give. There's just no way. You listen to me tonight. You hear me tonight. You obey me. Amen. You obey me. Okay? You listen. You are being parented right now, and you obey. You're not in charge. You're not in charge. You gave your life over to Jesus Christ. He is the master. He wants to instruct you. And as long as you're trying to school God and parent God and be his, you know, confidant, and counselor, ain't nothing ever going to happen. The Lord wants you to come under the rule tonight. And it's a beautiful thing to so submit your spirit. Because if you don't, you're going to have by virtue a hardness of spirit. And you're not going to be able to receive what God has given. I am done with the lifeless impact, the lifeless effect of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ on this planet, and especially in this nation. And I know the change begins with me, and the change begins with you. I've been preaching like this for 34 years. I'm not going to slow up. I mean, I know that it is a cure. It is the remedy when God's people begin to come under the mastery of the Holy Spirit and they begin to yield themselves as weapons of righteousness. Amen. Things change. You start moving in the word of faith. These people just rebellious. They just, I don't want to go to church there anymore because I'm not encouraged when he preaches. I'm always discouraged. Yeah, you're discouraged because you want to continue on the way you are. And I'm giving you no wiggle room. Hallelujah. You want to feel bad. You want to feel good about yourself. I'm not letting you feel good about yourself until you ultimately give yourself over to Jesus, and you can feel good about Jesus in you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord asked me to bring him a sacrifice and an offering and come before him with that which he has desired, that which he designed, that which he is called for. Abel did so, and the fire of God came. God asked for me to bring to him a holy sacrifice, one that's holy and acceptable. He asked me to bring to him the joy and the rejoicing offering before him with a conscience void of sin. And I brought that to him. And I want you to learn how to bring that to him. Otherwise, it's just a Cain response. And you wonder why that thing blew in your face. You wonder why you don't have a response and why you don't seem to feel the movings of the Spirit of God. You have to bring an offering that's acceptable to the Lord. Dear people, God wants to teach you how to build an altar in your life where you're coming and meeting with him in such a way that you can be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire every day. Hallelujah. And then when you begin to have that kind of fellowship, then when the wind and the waves and the storms that would threaten you would come your way, you'll immediately be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire because you know how to receive. I mean, you don't even have to ask. God just does it. He knows what you need. He's the help. But see, the help can't bring the help because we don't know how to yield, because we've never given ourselves to be fashioned. We've never been given ourselves to train. We've never been given ourselves over to his realms of divine glory where he has free course in our life. Tonight, I want you to come to a place that you decide that you're going to allow an altar be built in your life where the Holy Ghost and fire comes upon you every day. Every day. I mean, I'm talking about a divine glory, a rushing mighty wind where all of a sudden there becomes emotional expressions through you that are God the Holy Ghost. It's not you. Yeah. A divine outpouring of the Holy Ghost that you step back and you look at yourself and you go, this isn't me, this is God. This is amazing, this is beautiful. I like this, I'm going to do this from here on in. We want you to find how wonderful it is to fellowship with him. Dear people, he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm, and don't monetize that. Don't take the true riches and make a dollar bill out of it. Give me a break. That's on the back end, not the front end. I pray that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. And I'm going to talk to you about soul prosperity. I'm going to talk to you about the urgent need that exists in the church today, a lack of the fire of God burning in the midst of his people so that there is no light shining. Thus, the gross darkness is over the people and darkness over the land. It's about time people begin to desire the sincere nourishment of the word and begin to cry out for it like Naomi is here right now. Yeah, that milk comes. And now she's satisfied. She's only satisfied by it. Praise God, her mama's not giving her Coca-Cola. Praise God, her mama's not giving her Hawaiian punch. Hallelujah. Praise God, she has no palate nor appetite for it. But if her mom starts giving her Coca-Cola and starts giving her Hawaiian punch, she won't drink the milk. And there's too many people in the church living off of spiritual Hawaiian punch and Mountain Dew. Yes. I think that's worse than Coca-Cola. Yeah, and they spit out the milk. They have no taste for it. They have no palate for it. You start eating good stuff, I'm going to tell you right now, you spit out the bad stuff. My wife and I just basically cut sugar. And tonight, I said, honey, do you have any hot chocolate? You mind making me some? I was studying, and she said, sure. She brought me stuff. I said, oh, it's just way too sweet. I can't handle it, baby. Dilute it at least 75%, at least 75%. take 25% of it and see, just let's see if I can handle it. Well, it was a time not too long ago, probably about 4 or 5 years ago, the Lord spoke to us and said, cut salt out of your life. There's too much salt in the diet. There's too much salt in all the things that people are eating. Got them in your potato chips and everything that you find, you know, just it's just constantly being served to us. We can't even eat at restaurants anymore because it's like, pah! You just, it's too salty. It's just a mouthful of salt. It's like, take my tongue and, you know, put a salt shaker on the end of it and just fill my mouth with salt. And you just begin to be, you develop a palate for good things. And when you do, you're going to spit out the bad things. Huh? It's like one guy said, if it tastes good, spit it out. Yeah, that's because you've got a bad palate. You've got, so you're used to bad things. You know, and so it's going to be bad, but you get used to the good things, the good word of God. Ha! You get used to getting up in the morning and communing with the Holy Ghost. I'm going to tell you right now, you'll dance yourself a jig right there. I'm going to tell you right now, you'll get yourself to moving and shouting and praising. I'm telling you, you won't need no coffee. You won't sit around bummed out. Many people allow depression and things that belong to a realm of darkness to minister to their spirit, and they just go with it. Man, I tell you right now, I would allow depression for a minute. I'd get the boxing gloves out. I got a weapons of my warfare that are not carnal, but are mighty through God. I can pull down the strongholds. And I'm not, God is purpose that you and I do what he said to do so we can have the authority that he's given to us. But we're going to have to get engaged. We just got to stop just letting stuff flood our minds. A lot of the stuff that takes over our spirit, that takes over our emotions, are things that we sat there and thought about. Just let it. We just got a wide open. We don't even have a filter. So many people don't even have a filter. You know, and tonight we want to equip you. We want to help you to understand how to have the mind of the Spirit. You know, it's very rare. I'm one of the few people that even talk about divine health anymore. I try to hear somebody talking about divine health. I heard one person the other day talking about divine health. I said, wow, we're a dying breed. I hadn't heard anybody talk about divine health for a long time. They want to talk about getting healed, but how about an authority not to get sick? How about being able to be so strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might that when sickness comes, you say, you have no power over me. Well, you're going to have to do that with your emotions. If you can't do that with your emotions and feeling, you're not going to do that with your body, because that's a more in challenging realm. You need more faith for that realm. I mean, you know what? How hard is it to say, look at yourself and say, you're going to get happy right now? To talk to yourself, you sit right down. I said, if it's been a few minutes with you, and then you better listen up. Huh? How many people can command their spirit and submit their spirit to God? God has freed your spirit and given you the power and the ability to submit yourself to him. Hallelujah. I mean, yeah, in the Old Testament, yeah, it was, one who rules his spirit is mightier than the one who took a city. But now it ought to be a whole lot easier than that. Are you listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. Come on, Jake. I don't know. I have to ask. Once again, you guys look like Southern Californians under the prince and the power of the air. Oh, you listen to me, because I'm telling you like it is. Somebody said he's being mean. I'm being truthful. I'm telling you like it is. You're going to have to quit yielding your members to all that stuff that is so stoic and sedate and lifeless and despondent. You're going to have to let the Holy Ghost get activated in your life and quit pretending you got a river, and let's get one activated. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, as far as I'm concerned, I would just be happy with everybody under the garden hose. I'd just be happy with a garden hose expression of the Spirit of the Lord. And then we go ahead and move on up to a fire hose. And then we get to a spring. Hallelujah. And then we just grow that thing right on out to a creek. Praise God. Hallelujah. It won't take long and the river start flowing. I tell you, you give yourself to a garden hose experience of the flow of God the Holy Ghost out of your life every day, and it'll turn into a river quick. Amen. It just, people live in their human existence, and they live in the human mind, and they live in the human will. And the Lord Jesus said, listen, if you said you were going to go and you didn't, I'm going to tell you right now, harlots and publicans will come into the kingdom. And there's not a lot of difference. Democrats too. and everybody else that trusts in man to remedy their problems and bring to them the solution to their life's needs. You listen to me. You say, I'm going to tell you right now. I'm listening up. When Jesus is addressing the religious covenant people of the day, I put myself there. Because they believed they were right with God. They were covenant people. If there was anybody that had the rights, if there was anybody who had the resources, it was right there. It was right them, right then. I'm not going to pretend like, oh, look at those guys, man. You know, what a bunch of losers. I'm going to say, Lord, is it me? Am I doing that? If I said I would go and didn't go, you know, I'm definitely not going to say I won't go. I actually did say I won't go. When the men of God came around me and said, You need to go ahead and respond to the call of God upon your life. I said, no. And everybody was kind of shocked in the room because they were given prophetic words, you know, the mighty men of God. And I'm just like, I'm not. I love the Lord, but I'm not going to do that. And then I went and sobbed half the night and woke up the next morning and said, I'll do it. So I said, I wouldn't go, but I went. Amen. I'm going to do the will. Yeah. I'm going to do the will. I'm going to do the will of the Father. Hallelujah. I'm gonna respond to His voice. I'm gonna give myself. I mean, I tell you right now, here, people, you know, my dear friend Evangelist Tim Mahler comes around. He says, Mark, every time I come here, I want to go home and just go out in the woods and start fasting and praying because I feel like I've spent all my time for myself and not with the Lord. Well, you know what? You get around me, and what's going to happen is I feel the same way too. I need to go pray some more too. I need to go get in the Word. I need to go touch heaven myself. But I do that on, I'm moving. Yeah. Somebody said, how do you stay in such good shape? I don't stop. We don't slow down. We're constantly going. Yeah. We're on the run. But we're going to find, on the run, we're going to find time. And on the run, we're going to find a place where we're continually praying, where we're rejoicing forevermore. You show me a person who's rejoicing forevermore, I'll show you somebody who's always rejoicing. I'll show you somebody who's continually praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. People say, I'm praying in the Holy Ghost. You look like you've been praying in the pickle juice. You've been praying in something else. You look all, you know, you look bad. I'm going to tell you right now. All your makeup didn't cover up the problem you have in the spirit. And we want God to, we want you to allow God to beautify you. Hallelujah. He will beautify the meek with His salvation. That, and when we're talking about that, we're talking about His glory. Hallelujah. Habrabakataya. Hallelujah. I mean, just think about it. You can get up in the morning and you begin to touch heaven in such a way that you shine all day. Hallelujah. There's a place in a walk with God where you'd find yourself going from glory to glory. It gets better and better. I mean, it doesn't just stay, you know, like you don't have to stay the same. I mean, why on earth can people allow themselves to stay the same? I mean, is anybody still wearing the clothes they were wearing 20 years ago? Huh? I doubt that you are. I doubt it. Maybe there's one article of clothing that you never wear and you put on every once in a while and you've still got that for 20 years. But you know what? You don't have socks for 20 years and some other articles of clothing I'm not going to talk about. You just don't. You come on. You care about yourself. There's a need just by the use for there to be change going on in your life. Just by the use of the things of the Spirit, there has to be change going on. You can't hang out with God and not grow and mature. You can't stay in His presence and not be overwhelmed with His glory. I'm going to say it. Listen to me tonight. I'm telling you, Jesus said to us, I will be with you forever. He says, I will not leave you. I will be with you and in you. I mean, that is far greater than what Moses said, what God said to Joshua. He said, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. I mean, and Joshua did some pretty radical things. You talk about moving in divine authority to where that faith was so activated in his life. If you don't have authority, you're not going to move in faith. But God, the authority that God had given to him just in a limited realm, he was able to subdue nations. I mean, you talk about subduing nations. You talk about kicking everybody out that was ungodly. Give me a break. Look at what Joshua did. Look at the anointing in his life to where he could command the sun and the moon. Nobody's, I tell you, that walking on water's nothing compared to that. I mean, that's like elementary school stuff when it's commanding the solar system to put on its brakes. You know, you're telling the planets quit revolving around the sun. You just put your finger in the spoke, so to speak. Hallelujah. Moon, don't move. You're not going to rotate around the earth, and earth, you're not going to rotate around the sun. That means everybody else had to stop, too. All the rest of the planets, all the way out to Pluto, they all had to stop. And all their moons had to stop. Hallelujah. By one act of obedience, by one word of authority that came out of someone's mouth who was willing to walk with God, who was willing to step in to all that he, Father, had supplied, he was willing to take hold of it. And the people that were like him, another person that was like him who had a like spirit, like Joshua, is Caleb. And we see Caleb. I'm as strong as the day that was. When I first came into this land, give me this mountain. He's taking on the most fortified city and stronghold of the giants of the land. He said, "I'll take that mountain. I want that one." He could have had any place else. He could have taken, you know, some valley, some plush little, you know, hillside or whatever that really wasn't occupied by anyone too strong. He said, "No, I must subdue the mighty of the land." I mean, come on, to have the spirit of Joshua, to have the spirit of Caleb, to have the spirit that was there in Moses, to have the spirit that was that excellence of spirit that was there in the men of God. Then we talk about Elijah and we talk about Daniel. You know, people say, "Oh, it's Babylon, it's wickedness." Listen, Daniel really was in Babylon. It wasn't no kind of spiritualized Babylon, New York, United States of America, which, by the way, although there are Babylonian features, because it's just simply wickedness, that's what it looks like, Babylon, because there's a wickedness of the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit that works in children of disobedience. It is not, absolutely not Babylon. Babylon will rise in a day, and that is yet to come. But I'm going to tell you right now, you know, just like an individual must repent or perish, so shall a nation. And if this nation does not repent, this nation will perish. And that's a sad thing. And what's going to happen is people are going to be getting travail. They're going to be screaming and crying out to God. Your emotions are going to suddenly come alive. As soon as the blood's flowing, as soon as you don't have food, as soon as your loved ones are being taken out, you're going to start screaming and hollering. Suddenly, your emotions aren't dead anymore. Rut-row. I mean, you know, the reality of it is, people, we need to get some wisdom now. We need to get some sincerity now. You know, why wait till it's too late? The Lord started preparing me for these things that are to come over 20 years ago, because I have a role to play in what he wants to do in the ongoing, his church, and the ongoing vitality, if you would, of his church. And to be able to be in a position, hallelujah, to where there's latitude. I mean, I was hearing today about Israel, where they finally come to the place where they don't even need United States of America another 4 years. They're making themselves oil independent. They're making themselves sustainable in every way, where that they could produce enough food, take care of all their nation, and can still export over 400%, four times more, in other words, of what they need. And you know what? Praise God for some people who's got some wisdom, not sitting around twiddling their thumbs waiting to hear from God, because they just live in their life in independence. I praise God for people who's come around me and recognize my righteous cause, and that I've been stirred up by God to do something bigger than just take care of me and my four no more. Now it's more than four. Praise God. Hallelujah. Huh? Hallelujah. Me and my nine. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, I always say that my dear wife, she's a wonderful person. She raised five children, four's left home. And we're not sure the other one's going to ever grow up. She takes good care of us. Praise God. Hallelujah. Patala mandesha. What a mom. Hallelujah. Kishambra. I'm happy to be one of the kids. I'm well taken care of, man. Woo! Just like heaven. I'm telling you. I said to her today, I said, baby, what we're going to do is you're going to have to start preaching and ministering, and I'm going to start washing dishes and cooking. We're going to change roles for a year, and I'm going to see if I can survive that workload. She said, well, you know, we're just going to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and do what God's given us to do. Come on, man.
Yes.
Come on, people. Would you just come follow the Lord Jesus Christ and be faithful in what he's giving you to do? And if you will, you'll get promoted quick. If you're not happy, you want to go off doing something else, you're never going to move forward. You're actually going to find yourself being a terrorist to yourself. You're really causing all kinds of problems, and you don't need anybody. You go sit out all by yourself somewhere where nobody's around, and you'll just be just as bad off, maybe even worse. Huh? In fact, you would be, because you don't have anybody to sympathize and make you feel just a little bit better. I want you to know tonight that you don't need to have that going on in your life. You don't need to have that harassment going on in your life. You can't say you don't have the ability. If you've been born again, God is giving you the ability. He's given everything that you need to be successful. By his divine power, he's given you everything that you need. All the power you need, all the divine ability that you need to walk in godliness, to walk in the beauty and the splendor of his glory, okay? He's given you the power that you need in order to deal with harassing, tormenting thoughts. Any kind of thoughts that don't look like the authority of Christ Jesus, that don't look like the life of Christ Jesus, that begin to minister to you doubt, unbelief, fear, intimidation, all that mess, that begin to draw you away into other things. You learn how to say, no, I cut it off now. I'll tell you what, if you really want to spend time entertaining yourself, you can listen to those harassing, tormenting thoughts for like 30 seconds if you want. But go ahead and set your watch, because if you don't set a watch on this thing, you're just going to let it run wide open. So we're going to have to set a timer on it. Go ahead and just minister to yourself all that harassing, tormenting stuff, and in 30 seconds, shut it down. Say, okay, now you're done. And then I pray in Jesus' name, you wean yourself back to 15 seconds. And then I pray it won't take you long, and then you're about 5 seconds. You're going to listen to that thing for about 5 seconds. And then you up. And in this little attitude of, oh, hush, go away. Or this little meditative, like some people pray. Okay, let's all pray in the spirit. You got some people to go. That ain't going to work for you. I ain't going to do nothing. You're not going to bring one single thought into captivity with that posture. No. Oh, go away. Ain't going to work. Oh, leave me alone. Please leave me alone now. Ain't going to work. Huh? And then the Lord didn't say tiptoe through the tulips. He said tread. Okay, he said stomp. He said walk over top of. Huh? He didn't say walking on eggshells or anything like that. He said tread, stomp, dominate.
Amen.
Hallelujah. A force of violence, a passion of divine authority. When he talks about be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, take into yourself the whole armor of God, all that Father himself has. He's talking about us dealing with the spiritual wickedness, the powers of darkness, the spiritual wickedness that is in high places in which we are engaged in a wrestling match, and you're not going to sit around there not breaking a sweat and say you're wrestling with something. Give me a break. I tell you right now, you know, if I feel like giving a demonstration. There's a couple of you like Gustavo. I mean, tell you right now, Gustavo and I could put on a show for you. I throw him around this place. He'd probably throw me around a little bit. But I'll win because I'm in better shape than he is. Because I'm more determined. It isn't about this. It's about this. People think it's about this. I know people lift all kinds of weight and big old bulky hulks. And it ain't in that. It's in here. It's in the determination of the will. It's in the determination of the will. It's not in your body size. That's just in the natural. How about now where we become determined to participate with what God has invested into us and say, no, I'm not going to be stopped. When it comes to sickness, when it comes to disease, I think that everybody gets really passionate. I don't want sickness and disease. However, they don't know how to deal with it. I don't know how to have a defense against sickness and disease. How do you stand up against a virus? I mean, what? You know, what do you do? No, there is a way where you learn where you can stop sickness and disease. Where you understand how to function in the Holy Ghost to where you have authority against it and you start feeling it in your throat and you know how to move with divine power. You know how to first and foremost take a hold of an authority that has been given to us that God called, and Paul calls it in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, he calls it God power. And we say the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God. Well, that phrase, mighty through God, literally is God power. God has given us God power. He's given us his life. He's given us his glory. He's given us his own Holy Spirit. And what happens is although he's given us his Holy Spirit, and his Holy Spirit is one with our spirit, we better be careful, because if we're yielding our spirit to other things, we're going to get cut off from the supply of the Holy Ghost. We're going to have to learn how to, and it should be, it's supposed to be as natural as breathing. And by the way, on this Friday night, we're going to do a school of spirit. It's very important to you. I want you to come, because I want to show you one of the most fundamentally important things that you're going to have to grab a hold of if you're going to see maturity in the Holy Ghost come in your life. And I guarantee you, anybody on the planet that you see flowing in the gifts of the Spirit, flowing in the anointing in any measure or any degree, have found that they have in this place that I'm going to talk to you about on Friday night. So I want you to come. I want you to understand. Listen, you can have all of the anointing that there is to have, and if you do not know how to keep your confidence, that authority that is absolutely essential for the anointing to move through your life will be shut down. And here I look at a lot of people, and this is something that is symptomatic to the church everywhere. I know so many pastors. I know so many ministers, from large churches to small churches. They all got the same problem. The people don't know how to respond to the Spirit. They just all sit there and look. And then what happens is a man of God will begin to move in the Spirit, move the things of the Spirit, and I have him in here tonight. I'll begin to pray for people, begin to move in certain realms of the Spirit, and you will respond to it. You'll feel that presence. That presence will overwhelm you. Well, Father wants you to come to a place where his word will touch you, where this divine interaction, because see, actually, faith is going forth right now. Divine ability to do these things, okay? Hallelujah. You start eating right. I mean, you know, I'm so blessed. I was telling Ann yesterday, I'm just so blessed about the things that the Lord has shown us just from a nutritional basis, because I can take off running wide open up a hill and barely be winded. You know, I love health and no soreness in my joints. I'm 56 years old, and not having any kind of soreness in my joint is a great blessing. It is both function, first and foremost, of walking in divine health, and also listening to the Holy Ghost direct me on the things I should eat and shouldn't eat, and about discipline and responsibility that I'm supposed to have in my life in my place of accountability to God. So I'm not walking around talking about divine health and all, just can't hardly even move, you know. And it's all my fault. We somehow fail to recognize the personal responsibilities that we have to go to work. Hello. They just want to just kind of float into heaven. That's downstream, people. No. We're not floating in heaven. We're going upstream, okay? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. We're going against the course of this world, or the currents. It's another way to translate course. We're going against the currents. I'm telling you, you're going to learn how to get yourself some strength. And once again, that comes back to determination. Some of others that are in here, you know what it's like to be caught in the currents for 45 minutes to an hour. You're stuck. You cannot move. You're out there. The waves are coming in. 1981, the last time we had an El Nino, I got caught in some currents, man. I was out there. I was just nothing but muscle and sinew. I'm telling you, it was just... I was just in the best shape of my life. And the only thing that kept me from drowning was a determination. I was set. I had great confidence. I had so much confidence, not one bit of fear could. And so actually somebody came up to me and said, you want some help on his big surfboard and want some help? I said, no, I'm fine. I had such great confidence. no, I'm going to be fine. Well, listen, that's, I'm talking about things in the natural that some of you are able to do maybe in the natural. Somehow you're going to have to get over in the realms of the spiritual. And you're not going to do that trusted in yourself. It ain't going to be about muscle and sinew and self-confidence and experience and you've been here before and you can do this. Huh? I determined a long time ago, nobody can outrun me. I mean, you know, come on. Listen, you're running fast, I'm going to run faster. That's just, I guess some of us are just born with that more than others. And so, yeah, we can sort that out in the natural, but how about when we go over into the spiritual? We all born with the same skill set. We all born with the same divine potential. We all born with the same ability. We all can run the same speed. It's God's speed. And you know what? We all have the same strength and skills. God's strength and Father's skill. And he says to us, he empowers us. He says, I want you to be strong in my strength and in my power. And he's looking, and we're standing around going, I'm weak. I'm feeble. I can't. Too many people are leaving with babies now. I need to hear that baby crying. Come back in. Come back in. Come back in. Everybody, come back in. I mean, I want you to profit from the Word of God. I want you to grab a hold of the faith. I hate to be ministering the gospel. One thing is for not people not knowing how to respond to the things of the Spirit. Another thing is to see people continually bleeding. There's a bleed. You know, if there's a bleed in the body, you're going to go put a tourniquet on it or something. Are you with me? Let me shut the bleed off. We don't want you to die. These are hard things for people to put into place because they're so used to turning to other things other than God in order to see, to meet their needs, whether it's physically and for medically or, you know, financially. They're turning to other things. Men have learned to trust in the arm of flesh. This is a difficult thing to get people to step over into a realm to where that God says, listen, you don't have to pay for it. You can actually move into faith and speak it into existence. I'll put the word of my mouth, my word of my authority in your mouth, and you'll speak to the mountain and say to the mountain, and whatever you say, it have to obey. Well, you're going to have to be willing to be trained in that. And understanding that, Elizabeth, can everybody just come on back in? I can deal with the babies. I can deal with the babies. I've got to have some little fragment of hope that somebody is going to get this and start doing this before we all die. Yeah. I just got to have just give me a little fragment of hope. I'll talk over top of the screaming babies. They can be thrashing about even, you know, crawling over the chairs. I don't even care. If I had one little fragment of hope that there's somebody who can hear this and will start doing this with me, yes. I'm gonna feel encouraged. Because I can't crawl into your being and be your will. God will not do that. Father comes and declares to us an unlimited possibility. He describes to us this unlimited authority of God. How many of you just had this open? You've been praying over it, just saying, Lord, impart these things into my spirit. I want to get it in my spirit. Yeah. Well, I praise God for three, four. I praise God for four. Praise God for four. Because it ain't going to happen any other way. Yeah. There is no way. You're always at the crossroads of whether you're going to self-justify and say, I'm okay, I like things the way they are, or whether you're going to hunger and thirst. And God sets opportunities before you, and you can easily discount them. Just like Israel discounted over and over again the opportunities that God gave them. And they just made it something casual or coincidental or not essential because, you know, it's pass-fail here. It might be pass-fail for you, but I'm going for the grade. Yes. Huh? I got as much passion in my spirit as James and John. Let me sit on your right hand, your left hand. It's not mine to give. Father's going to decide whose it is. And I believe the decision is still open. I don't know about you. For me, I'm running a race, and I'm running to win. It's not just who comes over the finish line. Give me a break. I'm not going to be 99th. That's embarrassing. Just walk off and act like you were never there. Just act like you just like, you know. we're just sightseeing or something. You happen to get in the same lane. Go work out. Get yourself prepared for next year, then come back. Make a showing. I mean, I'm going to show you a verse of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10 tonight. Talking, I want you to turn there. God, get you there later. This is just doing announcements right now. But it's going to talk about how you and I are supposed to be display of all the mystery of the fellowship, all the mysteries of God and the mystery of His wisdom. We're supposed to be on display right now, showing principalities and powers. And we're not talking about the angels that followed the Lord Jesus Christ that followed Father. We're talking about those fallen evil spirits, showing them the glory of union and the glory of authority that has been given to us. And we're sitting around doing what? Consumed with our own needs, trying to have authority in our own life, to say no to sin. I was so blessed, as a Baptist preacher said last night, that he said this. He said, a Baptist preacher, Mike Huckabee, said this. He said, America doesn't have a skin problem, it's got a sin problem. Yes, I'm like, right. Goodness, break it down, man of God. Somebody speaking out some truth. Ain't no way he's getting elected. You got to learn how to lie. You got to tell big lies that everybody wants to hear. You speak the truth. Oh, God, the only way he could get elected is if all of God's people were given over to the truth and would rise up in truth. And we aren't even close to doing that. We are so far from that, there is no threat. Hell has on their radar no threat. No threat. It's a one-minute battle. You know, these guys in Russia and the Pentagon and others, they'll strategize, well, if the battle breaks out like this, how many days will it go on? They'll do this, we'll do that, they'll do this, we'll do that. They'll talk about, you know, the various different strategic moves after that battle, how much the next battle, and then they begin to try to calculate the entire war, okay? Hell goes, okay, bring it on, church. They'll last about 1 second against us. Because it's repeated every day. We see it. We're watching it. We got to measure. It's measured now with what the Supreme Court decision was just a few weeks ago. The deplorable state of the United States of America just before the Civil War empowered the supreme authorities to do the exact same thing. What the Supreme Court said that just before the Civil War was just absolutely horrific what they said about you people. Horrific. And it resulted in great chaos. And what just took place is unprecedented in humanity. It's unprecedented in the history of humanity. And it's because there's a sleeping church that does not know how to respond to the anointing. Oh, if it's sensationalism, if it's excitement, ooh, excitement. Waving some flag, blowing some horn, everybody's in. But just now let us begin to participate on knowing how to begin to move in authority to shut down everything unlike God. And now it's like things just start breaking apart. I'm telling you right now, somebody said to me, you general, if I was a general, things that we'd have an army. I'm a sergeant trying to get an army ready. Huh? Somebody said, well, can't you be talking more confident and more positive about us? No, we're going to have to break down the reality. You can't run. You fat and out of shape. Don't tell me that. You can't run, you fat and out of shape. He was still dreaming that they're 19 years old. You're not 19 years old. Huh? You can't do the things you did when you were 19 years old. You'll die of a heart attack. You might think in your mind that you can do it. No, man, I tell you right now. Your heart will fail you. You'll faint. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It's time. It's time God's people get in shape. It's time the church gets spiritually in shape.
Amen.
It's time that you learn how to endure in hardness. It's time that you begin to stand up against a little bit of resistance. It's time you quit bowing to every suggestion that Satan comes along with concerning the physical state of your body, the financial state that you have in terms of your needs. It's time that you begin to understand that you have authority. God gave you authority. You have the authority to stand up against every principality and power and wickedness, including Lucifer himself, including the chief imp. tried to tell me about the power of Lucifer the other day. I said, just shut up. I said, he come around here, I'll smack him. He said, if you want me, if he comes around your life, you don't know what to do, just call me, I'll smack him for you. The only time I've noticed that he's been around is when I check the bottom of my shoes and see some slime there. I know, oh, I must have run over top of him. He has no place. He has no place. He's going to push you and shove you around and try to tell you who you are, but you're not, you know, you're not pleasing unto God. What if you're not acceptable to God? You don't have this authority. You can't do these things. And so many people are listening to him. And it's time you start listening to God. It's time that you get your defense becomes the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not going to get into this tonight, but I'm going to tell you there's this one chapter in here on the authority of faith. It's one section on the authority of faith. You ought to hover over it. You don't have to hover over necessarily my words, because all I'm doing is just declaring what the Scripture says. Just hover over the passage of Scripture and just find out, wait a minute, he's not like other theologians. He's not like other teachers of the Word. He's actually putting this on my shoulders and saying, this is what God's given to me to do. Come on now. Come on now. Listen, people, you're going to have to get past some little spirit of offense. You're going to have to get past some little sickness, some little, you know, as one dear brother said, stick demon, who's blind in both eyes, deaf in both ears, paralyzed from the neck down, and that's all it takes to keep you from moving forward in God. Come on, come graduate to at least some kind of angel or something. But of course, when you can overthrow the one small thing, you can overthrow the everything. And that's why Satan's going to keep you chasing small things, and he's going to keep you from advancing with silly little earthly concerns. And this way, the Lord says, you can't mingle it. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to compromise yourself if you get all attached to the cares of this life, you get all wrapped around all of your issues with respect to food and clothing and how you're going to be successful and pay your bills. Guess what? All you guys have been weary at paying your bills. I bet you're just in debt as much as you were 10 years ago, and probably even worse. Huh? I'm not. Huh? Because I'm not waiting to live in the blessing. I'm living in the blessing right now. Hallelujah. Father, bring you to a place where your assets are so far bigger than your debts. Praise God. Hallelujah. And then shows you a clear way forward to where that all the debts are gone, so that you can step into bigger arenas of prosperity and influence. Hallelujah. Tiranasay. Blessed is the name of the Lord. You know, it's actually raining in here, literally. I was going to say, well, it's raining. Now, there's times where it's raining in here in the spirit. And I don't really say anything about it. Just, you know, because I don't want, sorry, people are already distracted. Now they're looking around for the rain. It's like, you either know it or you don't know it, man. I mean, there's supernatural, there's amazing. Woo! There's amazing supernatural things going on here all the time. Even when it looks like it's intense and my veins are popping out the side of my neck, there's miracles, signs and wonders, intense demonstration of the Holy Ghost. When it's coming at you, you don't even know what's happening. People say, oh, we don't want God to talk to us. You go hear what he's got saying, you come back and we'll listen to you. Those people won't listen to the man of God before long either. It just keeps it running. Ronald, we're not going to listen to you. We're going to listen to some junior. Now we're not going to listen to the junior. We're going to listen to some, you know. We're going to listen in our own head and really just listen. You're either listening to the Spirit of the Lord or you're listening to the demon spirits. I'm going to tell you, God will not force himself upon you. Satan, the atmosphere that is around us, there is an atmosphere. It's like a consciousness, as it were. It's like a thought, a mentality that is present in the atmosphere. It will force itself on you. And the only way that you can begin to deal with it is that you understand how to have a continual infilling. You've got to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. You've got to find an altar. You've got to find a place where the fire and the glory of God can come upon you so that you can be filled up. That is where you're supplied with the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. If you're not being filled, if you're not having that encounter, you're not getting the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Huh? I mean, dear Anna, she brought me some tea yesterday when we were moving in. She fixed up some tea for me on her little stove. There was nothing in it. I act like I'm drinking. I said, this is religion, an empty vessel with nothing in it. Father wants you to be an empty vessel filled with him. Religion, empty vessel with nothing in it. You listen to me. Huh? God, then she brought me some biscuits. And that was, again, an empty vessel with nothing in it. But I ate it to go ahead and participate with the program. Which I didn't mind at all because, you know, she doesn't know any better. That's what she's doing. That's what she's got to give. That's what she got a cup to give. That's what she gave. She had a plate to give, and that's what she gave. Praise God. But I'm going to tell you right now, in a few years, if she brings me that, I'm going to say, what is wrong with you? Come here, I'm going to pray with you. Huh? When she's 10, 12 years old, she better not be bringing me no empty cup. I better not be sitting down at the table and getting an empty plate. It's not going to happen because she's going to grow. Right. And she's going to put away childish things. Hallelujah. God wants us to put away childish things. In other words, he wants us to stop living in the carnality that Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He said, look, you guys aren't moving forward because you're stuck over here living like mere men. And you got arguments and you got strife and you got debates. And some of you saying you're Presbyterians and some of you saying you're Pentecostals. And some of you saying, huh? Of course, they probably wasn't no Presbyterians then. Huh? Because I guarantee you Apollos was not a Presbyterian. He was a Pentecostal. At least they had some good choices. Cephas was not a Methodist. He was a Pentecostal. Pentecostal is the oldest, longest-lasting expression of the church that exists even to this day. It's the first one, and it's going to be the last one. Praise God. And everybody who wants to get in the big middle of what God's doing is going to join up. Hallelujah. I'm joining up. I'm joining up with a greater participation because it's not a denomination. It's the church. Yes. It's the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. People can try to lay claim to the name. They don't have it. I'm not going to go into that. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 19. Go to 1 Peter with me, chapter 4. I'm going to find out where I'm at. Forgive me. 1 Peter chapter 3. In verse 22, hasta kinemia, hasta kinemia si paranayo, este paranishi pikala. Hallelujah. Si kinemantaya. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Woohoo! Praise God. Ha ha. Amen. She started praising the Lord. Praise God for some response. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray you be converted and become like a little child, not feel all threatened all the time. You know what I mean? That's the domination of fear. Threatened. He's talking about me. Fear, intimidation. Not giving us a spirit of bondage to fear, but he's giving us a spirit of sonship, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. And if sons, heirs. Heirs of God. Join heirs with Christ Jesus. Woohoo! 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 That is the only proper response. That is the only proper response to the word of faith. Ha 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 ha! Faith believes it. Faith believes it. It's like, whoa! Like, you gotta be kidding. This is great! Woohoo! It's like when Jack Cole was first touched with the power of God and understood that all these things was his. He's like, hot dog! He didn't know how to say anything else but hot dog. That was all. That was the expression of the day. You excited? Hot dog. What an expression. Amen. Praise God, we a little bit more advanced in the spirit and our expression in the spirit. Amen. You're wonderful, baby. Can I have a kiss? Now, there's a day and time where she wouldn't do that in public. I praise God for discreet and chaste women. Praise God. Thank you, mighty God, for that. Toda manzeseli. A woman without discretion is like a jewel in the nose of a pig. This is not fitting. Just don't make, are you with me? Hallelujah. Get discretion. Amen. Get some clothes on. Hallelujah. Present yourself properly. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, blessed is the name of the Lord. I just like feel like singing God is so good right now, you know? Hallelujah. That's what happens. You get drunk, you just go to singing. You can't preach no more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so good. 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 He's so good to me. Oh, God is so good. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah. God is so good. He's so good to me. I just pray that you walk around singing that all day long. Hallelujah. I mean, that, you know, those are kind of some of the things that the Lord gives us to do when we're first learning how to deal with the selling thoughts of the enemy. You know, it starts flooding your mind. Why you sit there listening to it? Get to singing. Amen. Get to shouting. Yes. Get to dancing around giving thanks, because otherwise you're not going to shut it down. It's a dominating voice that you think is your reasoning, your logical reasoning, an examination, faithful examination of all the facts. Give me a break. I can't find God in any of that mess. And so it's certainly not an examination of all the facts, and it's by far, far, far away from an examination of all the truth. It's a lie trying to take you into prison so that now the blessings of God can't be yours, to deceive you and lie to you and to bring you into bondage so that you can't move in the faith and in the confidence and the authority that is essential to have that which God supplies. You don't have to earn it, but you're going to have to believe it, and you're going to have to recognize that there is going to be a wind of opposition blowing against you. Folks just can't get it. I mean, the Lord Jesus commanded them to go to the other side. And you just think, well, they'd put the boat in. You know, they all, you know, a lot of people's doctrine, they put the boat in, and there just so happened to be a current that just jetted them right to the other side. Ooh, didn't even have to pedal. Then you had to put up the sails. That's just so easy. We'd have gotten the boat and boom, we're there. Because we went in the word of the Lord, and it was by his word and by his direction, it was all so easy. No, the wind and the wave were contrary to them. So they couldn't make it. They spent all night getting, you know, 1/8 of the distance across it. 1/8 of the distance out. They're barely, it is like looking back there, and they're still basically the same distance from the shore, just that now they've just floated down the shoreline a bit. Many of the things that we, and I might even say that the majority of the things that God commissions us and tells us to go do, we're going to be met with such opposition. But the point of it is we don't stop. We don't say, you know what, look, let's just turn around, because we know, because they were seamen. They understood. Let's just turn around and we'll go back to the shore and we'll make a little campfire. And we'll have them roast a few fishes and, you know, just kind of pull out the sleeping cots. And we'll wait till the morning and then Passover, and then be easy sailing. And the time will change and the currents will be with us. Huh? That's what we do in the rational thinking of our mind. God said go. It's not a convenient time to go. The wind's not right. The waves aren't right. Praise God, they got in the boat and they didn't stop. Their life was threatened. They thought they were going to die here, but they didn't stop moving forward. Do you know how easy it is in that situation to turn around and how quick you are back to shore? That part of it doesn't necessarily stand out to be obvious, but unless you're a seaman, unless you know the currents and the way the things work in the water. They stayed with it. The Lord told them to go to the other side, and they persistently said, he said, go to the other side. Hey, we should turn around. The Lord said, go to the other side. I can hear John. The Lord said, go to the other side. Peter, I think we'd better. The Lord said to go to the other side. There was a few people who would not change their opinion. Thomas was like from the first, like from the very beginning. Guys, this is stupid. The Lord's testing us to see if we've got any sense or wisdom to know what to do in these particular situations, and to see if we're just going to be willing to stand on our own two feet and make the right kind of decisions based upon the circumstance. Hey, are you with me? Does that sound familiar to you? I know it does.
Yeah.
Because we're all cousins to Thomas and to Peter and to John. And fortunately, I really want to leave Judas out of the equation, but unfortunately, I cannot. We're making the decision of what we're going to do. It was there in that context that Jesus came to them. Ooh. And they began to see a revelation in Jesus that they had never seen before, that propelled them into a faith that otherwise they would have never had because of their faithfulness not to give up, not to submit to the contrary wind and to the wave. You're going to have to just understand this, dear people, if you're going to walk in authority. Somebody says, why don't we have this going on? Because nobody's willing to pay the price and stand faithfully and not bend or bow. They bend and bow all the time. They redefine God's word and take all the power and all the faith out of it. And thus we're left with nothing but religion. God the Holy Ghost steps out of the room when we go to redefining. He steps out of the word when we go to redefining. Are you listening to me? Come on, dear people. Papa's talking to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He wants you to get some determination. This is where I'm going to just say the word we used to sing when we were younger. Just like a tree planted by the water. I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. I remember one day the zeal of the Lord came over me while I was singing that song. And I mean, I'm telling you, I shall not be, you know. It became a moment in my life where everything was certain now. I will not budge, I will not bend, I will not bow, I will not be threatened and intimidated by the lies of Satan and circumstances that would try to keep me out of this walking in this realm of divine power and glory. I'm saying this to you tonight because you're going to have to get determined. You're not going to move a big oak tree that's planted by the water. It's roots go down deep. You're not going to be changing what it is you believe to accommodate whatever painful or stressful or adverse situation that you're in. You're going to stand, and having done all, stand. Listen. You stand, and having done all to stand, gird yourself. Put on. Hallelujah. Be equipped, as Paul describes what it looks like as you consciously take into yourself the whole armor of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Tasta kanadeshi. Are you with me? 1 Peter chapter 4. Hallelujah. What's that song? Naomi's doing El Hombre de Galileo. Okay, guys, let's pull ourselves together. Now, because the other ones are saying, why can't I get down, run around with her too? I want to turn. In Jesus' name, touch him now, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah. Filled up. Amen. Amen. That's right. Hey, praise God. Amen. I tell you, I'm just looking for any kind of response. Tonight, I'm happy with any kind of response. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I don't know. I would even probably go with burps. I mean, anything. Any kind of reaction. any kind of movement whatsoever, the blinking of the eye, well, just the blinking of the eye. Just any kind of response, any kind of indication that people are still alive, that there's still movement. Just something. I love the Bakaranaya. I love the Rashaparadoya. I love those Adamaki Karana Shapaya Nabasutaya. I love the Karamashapana Rabamon today. Mom, but you're going to have no spirit of fear on you to do that. There's a glorious liberty in the sons of God where you know nothing can threaten you and intimidate you. You have then proven that you're not hiding behind the rocks and behind the caves, all trembly over the fact that there's some little, you know, guy out there named Goliath. Just so happens to be about 5 foot taller than anybody else. Well, actually, 6 foot taller than anybody else. Not threatened by nothing. Hallelujah. Ha ba ba se ke ya ba ha ha. Thank you, Lord. I just want to talk to you about Jesus and who he is for just a minute here. In 1 Peter 4:22, he's gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. And I want you to understand that when the Lord is talking about angels and authorities and powers being made subject to him, he's not talking about the angels of the Lord, because they already are that. They were that already. Before Jesus came and spoiled principalities and powers and mights, he's talking about the devil. Hallelujah. It don't matter what's going on. Christ, they are subject to Christ Jesus, and he's given us all authority in his name. It's just he's looking for somebody to agree with him. It's burning in my spirit. God downloaded this to me in such an incredible way, personally, where it became a personal responsibility to me in another dimension. While I was in Japan, you've heard the story. I want these things to become personal to you, and they're not going to become personal to you till you get yourself in the fight. You have to get yourself in the battle. You have to be minding more than just what's going on in your little life, in your little cosmos. What a small cosmos that is. When Father has given us the privilege to come sit with him in the heavenly realm over all things, we want to sit over isolate our little world, you know. Make believe and all these problems. Of course, we make believe. We don't make believe good stuff. We make believe bad stuff. We are just verifiable idiots. I mean, you know, we should at least sit around and make believe that everything is good and wonderful and is, you know, and instead we do this the opposite. We make it all bad and threatening. We're all going to die tomorrow morning. We probably won't wake up. Lord, help us. This is who Jesus is. He's gone into heaven. And you know, when you begin to reckon with that, especially in the context that we in that realm with him, he's translated us out of the realm that we've been living in, under the place where we were subject, where we had to listen to and then ultimately reap, as it were, the consequences of what demonic powers were doing. We've been delivered out of that. So just go with me quickly to Colossians, and let me just touch down there with you for just a minute. If I could just to convince you who Jesus is. And then I could convince you to have faith to be a son and not just faith to be a servant. If we could just convince you to have faith to be a son instead of faith to be a servant. Hallelujah. Praise God. Suddenly you're going to step into a place where you talk to Father in a different way. When you begin to talk to Father in a faith realm, he begins to reveal himself. He begins to make himself known. See, nobody has anything unless no one has any authority unless he receives it from heaven. Well, we have received authority from heaven, but we've not allowed it to be personalized to the degree that Father wants to personalize it. He wants to personalize sonship on the level that you read about in that relationship that existed between Jesus and the Father in John chapter 5. And if I can tonight, I'm going to try to get there. If I don't get there tonight, I'll get there another night. And what's going on? You listen to me. There's a miraculous word of the living God going forth that will produce faith in those who hear it, if you know how to shut down all the other lies and nonsense. But a lot of that's not learned in church any more than your children learn how to sit still in church. It helps, but they learn how to sit still and they learn how to be obedient to you offline. You learn how to shut down thoughts and things that would distract you and keep you from receiving those things which God is supplying, because you have a relationship with him at home where you receiving that which he's supplying to be able to deal with all the threats of the atmosphere and all the winds and the waves of the spiritual powers of darkness that would be contrary to us obeying God, being who God told us that we are. So turn to Colossians quickly with me. Colossians chapter 1. And of course, you know this verse of scripture because I'm always quoting it. I'm always speaking it. It's a powerful verse of scripture. I spend a lot of time trying to help people understand that the old man is completely done away with. The new creation has come. You've been given the divine nature, oneness with God. There is absolutely nothing in your life that is in any way unacceptable to the Lord, so that they can be now on a foundation of faith and confidence to begin to move in the authority of sonship. And it's like, I don't know what to do. I'm at a loss. And the good thing is I'm happy to be in a company of a lot of other people that are lost. We don't even know what to say to the people. The people just are sitting there looking at us. Why? Because of the press of this world, the demands of you to obey and bow your knee to its 8 to 10 hour job, and all the other stuff, and all the other influences that makes you a God in a human form. You're not. That makes you the ruler of your own destiny and the person who decides what it is that you're going to do and it's all going to work out. It's not. You get to decide, yeah, but it ain't going to work out. You get to do whatever you want to do, but it ain't going to work out. It's about time people humbling themselves under the mighty hand of God, submitting themselves to him. Because I'm telling you, people, this thing is running amok. We're going to have to understand somebody's going to have to start moving in an authority that has been given, no matter what it costs you. If you die, believe in God, die. Ann and I are sold out on this. We've made a covenant with each other. We will, before we bow to the system, we'd rather die believing God.
Amen.
And I guarantee you're going to see us living. I mean, I'm telling you right now, we sold out to it on the same level that we sold out to it when the Maoists were saying they were going to kill us if we came to Nepal. We sold out on that same level. Doesn't matter. We're going to believe God. We're not going to bend and we're not going to bow. We're going to declare what God said would happen. We're going to speak the mountain. We won't stop speaking the mountain. We're going to look at the threats, listen to hear the threats of the devil and laugh at him and tell him he's a lying idiot. And if he comes around again, comes around here again, we're going to smack him into oblivion. Something like that. You know, anything like that will do. Just get aggressive in Jesus' name. To where he can't threaten you. Jesus. More? What more do you want more of? More? I hope everybody's like going more. Everybody knows sign language for more, right? More? Go ahead, do that some. Come on, give me something. That's fine. I'm going with that. I'm happy. I got something rather than... come on, I'm just like interested in any activation movement. The body without the spirit is dead. Dead body. Spirit makes you moving around. Going, yeah, praise God, something, stretching, yawning, something, and digging in your ear, something. At least I know somebody's trying to hear, you're trying to tune in. Come on, man, give me something to work with. Hallelujah. Give me something to work with. Let me see some faith. I want to see you hook up in faith. That's right, if you're going to do it properly. If you're going to do it properly, Mike. That's right. Not just like a little. Yeah. You know what? Come on. There you go. Hallelujah. Dear people, the Lord just made us to everything we do it passionately, we do it ferociously, we do it intensely. whether it's working or whether it's praying or whether it's preaching, everything about our life is intense. We don't have no kind of just lackadaisical, just hanging out, being lazy. We don't do that. We don't do lazy. We don't do lazy. We do active. We do passionate. We do intense. We do ferocious. Hallelujah. Come on, people. And especially in the things of the Spirit. Mam Jesurataya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Paul Karaman Jeritane. Hallelujah. Listen, you can enjoy the meeting. You can enjoy eating. We're not serving green beans and sauerkraut. You can sit up at the table and enjoy the meal. You can enjoy the meeting. We're not serving apple cider vinegar. We're not. We're serving fresh juice over here. Hallelujah. You can enjoy the meeting. Praise God. You can go, amen. You can go, I want that. You can go like, you can go like this. You can go, if you can't speak, if you mute, you can do this. Anything. But the reality of it is you're going to have to lay hold on God. You're going to have to respond to God on the level that His word should be worthy of. That He says this, because otherwise you're not in belief. You're in doubt. You're not in faith. You're just like going, whoa, no way. Nah. But when it's yours and it's deposited in your bank account, you're like, woo! Yeah! We good! Hallelujah! That's somehow, that's got to kick into your life. I mean, listen, I felt myself so many times dealing with some of you to where it's like, man, this is just going nowhere. This is getting deeper into a ditch. It's like, oh, this is what goes on in the mental exercises of some people's lives. Instead of there being correction, it becomes even that bigger of a bigger discouragement. And it's a completely demonic realm. And it's like, wait a minute, there is no faith there. There is no life there. There is no connectivity with the Holy Ghost there. There is no Holy Ghost bearing witness with your spirit. Because you're overwhelmed by listening to the voices, the lies, the doubt, the unbelief, the things that purely make you nothing more than a human being who's trying to make it through life over here like this. In Jesus' name. Pambro Sataya. In the Masaleatai, in Jesus' name, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Did everybody turn with me? Hallelujah. Did you turn over there to Colossians? I'm in 1 John 4. Turn Colossians. While you're over there, I'm coming. Colossians chapter, yeah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Man, I don't even only know where Colossians is. Because you read here in verse 12, verse 11, it's hard to break in here. Verse 10, I don't even know how I can start there. But I'm going to start there, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord and all pleasing. That's what I'm going to do. That's what Ann's doing. I think I heard somebody else, but a couple of us are like so stoked that we get to be doing that because we've been empowered by God. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm not going to be a part of the dead, silent, frozen, not chosen church. I'm going to get moving around. I'm going to get active. You need to start speaking out. You start speaking out in church, you'll probably start speaking out outside of the church too. Huh? You start getting happy in the midst of the church, you'll probably get happy in the midst of your house. My goodness. And people say, who is this that we're living with? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your dog will look at you a different look. start wagging his tail more. Everybody's happy in there now. Hallelujah. That ye might walk worthy of the Lord, and all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. And you're not going to have any, this is a progression. You're not going to have any of these things unless you're just willing to be pleasing, unless you just want to obey God and do what he's asked you to do. And he says, strengthen. This is what he's doing for you, for us, so that we can do this. Strengthen with all might. We strengthen with all power. You know, that's really right along the same lines of Paul saying, be strong in the strength and the power of his might. It's right along the same lines of what he said, be strengthened in your inner man by the Holy Ghost. I mean, he's just telling, when he tells us about all these wonderful big things that God would do through our lives and the ability he's given to us to be able to meet the challenge, he's always declaring to us, I've got you supplied. Hallelujah. I'm going to have proof that I am a servant of the living God. There's going to be proof in my life that God is my master. That he is in charge of my every desire and every expression. And it all really comes down to this relationship where we're willing to do what he says and he supplies the ability. That's the fundamental basis of the relationship. And nobody has to be taken with sin anymore if you come into the relationship. Nobody got to be taken with sickness and disease. You don't have to live in poverty and oppression. You get to step right over. I don't care if you're minus $2 million in the hole right now. You could step over into this realm of faith and in no time begin to walk into a divine ability to where all of a sudden God's doing great things through your life, even in the financial realm, because it has nothing to do with human ability. It has everything to do with how you receive from God divine power, divine strength to function in faith. Faith is a supernatural realm that belongs to the children of the living God. Hallelujah. And I'm today, there's not one thing that's lazy about faith. Now, I have friends of mine who are moving in some amazing faith, but they don't sleep good at night. I just told one friend of mine, I said, you know what? You're going to have to get over that. Otherwise, God's not going to be able to use you. You're going to die of sleep deprivation. You got to learn how to just let it go. But at least he's moving wide open, even though it cost him his sleep. Praise God for that. Hallelujah. Mambron taking the mountain. Where are the Calebs? Where are the Joshuas this day? You're going to have to begin to have this evidenced in your life, because you say, I'm going to walk into all pleasing. I'm going to be fruitful in every good work. And when I'm fruitful in every good work, God is talking about our lives expressing the life of Jesus Christ, the ministry of the life of God. You're not going to do that being hog-tied by your circumstance and situation. Quit being a terrorist to yourself. Quit holding yourself hostage. Huh? Quit locking yourself up in a prison every day. Huh? Quit beating yourself. Flogging yourself. Walking up the stairs with broken glass. Jesus. Quit doing that. It's horrific. Strengthened with all might. Woo! According to his glorious power. Paul sounds just like Peter, don't he? Paul and Peter must have been preaching on the same message. Preaching the same sermon. Hallelujah. That according to his divine power, he's given us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness, to God kind of life and the God kind of power, because he's called us to glory and virtue.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Sounds the same way, same thing. I know, I've got a supply. You're going to have to know. I want you to be convinced tonight that God has given you a supply. You have everything that you have need of. And all you have to do is begin to talk with him and interact with him and begin to depend upon him and rely upon him. And everything about your life will change. And I'm going to tell you right now, his wrath is about to be revealed against all sin and iniquity and all ungodliness, because every man everywhere is without excuse. Men are without excuse. They want to try to have an excuse and a cloak for their sin and the shame, and there is none. There is none. It's an abdication of divine authority that he's given to the sons. His sons, his children, are those who are more than conquerors, those who are overcomers, those who have learned how to rely upon this heavenly supply that has come to us by the Holy Ghost, because we're hungry, because we're thirsty, because we can't live without these things. Because we got to have it. Because we have to have this. Because we can't just walk around and pretend that whatever we bind on earth is bound in heaven, or whatever we bind in heaven is bound on earth. Whatever we bind on earth, God binds it in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth, God looses it in heaven. Hallelujah. Because he set us in a place of authority. He himself has authority. And he strengthened us with the might and the divine ability to exercise his divine authority. Hallelujah. Manganda bora shehatai. Hallelujah. Look at it. Strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, in thus supplying us. And what this does, it supplies us with all patience. Patience. Guess what patience does? Receives the promises. Hallelujah. Patience. Long suffering. These things, like, these are words of endurance. Somebody who will not weary. Who will not faint. Somebody, one time I had a superintendent of the Assemblies of God say, I want you to come and I want you to do a pastor's conference and on burnout. I said, you know, listen, man, I'll tell you right now, I'll give you the cure right now. I won't even need to come. They that wait upon the Lord will not burn out. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and not faint. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is what the Lord is talking to us about here, the endurance that he gives to us. The ability to stand against nations, the ability to stand against circumstances, ability to stand against the natural elements, the realm to be able to stand in the midst of the fire and not be burned, to quench the violence of fire. Come on, I love this realm. The ability to look at someone dead and say, get up and live right now in Jesus' name. The ability to begin to move into great exploits. Yeah, I'm telling you, wickedness is getting worse. Iniquity is getting worse. But grace is supposed to be of greater impact and greater effect. It's time for the miracles and the signs and the wonders to go to a whole new level of magnitude in somebody who knows how not to be moved. Somebody who knows how to put their fingers in someone's ears and not stop praying till they hear. Even if it takes 45 minutes to an hour. Woo! Come on, man. Yeah. I'm with you. People are not going to bend, not going to bow to the threats, to the fear. Most of the stuff, you don't do it because you're afraid. Fear, intimidation. Come on, man. How can you be a coward when God's given us so much boldness? How could we be cowards when we don't even care about our own life? I mean, that's what makes valiant soldiers. They resign themselves to die on the battlefield. Stonewall Jackson had resigned himself to die on the battlefield. He didn't move. He had resigned himself to die. He wasn't planning on living beyond the battle. Come on, people. Why don't you stop preserving your own life? You've already been crucified with Christ, buried within the baptism into his death. You're not supposed to be living your own life anymore. I mean, having resigned yourself completely over to him, you should no longer have any fear. Hallelujah. This relationship and this perfect love cast out all fear. Hallelujah. Fear has torment. There's a lot of people being tormented. I want you to quit being tormented. I want you to quit living in sorrow and depression and sadness because you're overwhelmed. Statistics say that people are only happy 20% of the time. 80% of the time, they're overwhelmed, they're depressed, they feel bad about themselves because they're failing. They feel like they're failing at everything. They're not good enough at everything. And I guarantee you, that's the upper, you know, level of those folks in society. Think, are you happy 20% of the time? Measure it. You might be surprised. Because if you are too much under the influence of the atmosphere of a social structure and just moving you know, with what everybody else is moving. Oh, the movie's really good. Let's go see it. That's what the world's doing. It's just one big vacuum, one big whirlwind. Oh, this new dress. Oh, this new food. Oh, this new restaurant. It's just the mind of the spirit of this world. I don't have nothing to do. It has nothing in me. There's nothing in me. And if you're under the influence of that thing, huh?
Break it off.
You're under the influence. A lot of people are just, they are stopped and shut down because the only thing that's really going on in their life that's wrong is murmuring and complaining. Can you imagine what a wretched life that is? You just all murmuring. A murmurer. What a wretched existence, complaining. What a wretched existence. If you're going to sin, do something big. Do something exciting. You know, do something that's got some adrenaline to it or something, man. Murmuring and complaining, going to hell, murmuring, complaining. Your whole existence, you're held back, can't do nothing because you're murmuring, complaining. And this fear, it's terrible, man. To think that that is one of the chief strongholds of Satan among God's people, and has been that way for over 3,400 years. Come on, people. I pray in the name of Jesus you don't allow any of that kind of stuff. That's ugly. That's bad ugly. I can't make that ugly of a face. I try. I practice in the mirror. Lord wants to beautify you. He's given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. Hallelujah. He put praise and thanksgiving in your heart. He's giving you the Spirit of the Son, who says, Abba, Father, I want to be pleasing unto you. I want to be pleasing and fruitful in every good work. That's just the Spirit of the Son. Hallelujah. Of those who are walking into glorious liberty. I'm about ready to take off over here, man. Just about all I can do to hold myself down, man. I'm about ready to do a jig and run around. Just out of excitement and the thrill of this place that God has given me, because it's so real to me. I feel it in every part of my body. I feel it in every part of my being. And I want you to enjoy these things too. I'm not going to just leave them alone. Just let them be miserable. Just let them miss out on all the blessings of God. They'll wake up someday. People don't wake up. It takes a strong, shouting voice to get people up out of their sleep. And God gave me one. I got a shout over here. And I'm not going to be quiet. Ain't nobody can make me be quiet. Praise God. If I was in a prison, I'd be screaming. Hallelujah. Habraba, lift up my voice. Tekana man bredeya. Hala supron. Don't matter. Giving thanks unto the Father. In this realm of joyfulness, which has made us able, given us the ability to be partakers of the inheritance, to be partakers of that which God gave to His only begotten Son when He raised Him up from the dead, set Him His own right hand in the heavenly places, and set us together there with Him, that inheritance. I have been given divine power. I've got the divine ability. I'm living in this. I'm bathing myself in these things. I don't have to put like a little string around my finger to remember you got the inheritance. Oh, this string means I'm an heir. This string means I'm supposed to be giving thanks. I don't have to put strings around my finger. These things are written upon the tables of my heart. Hallelujah. It's gushing up out of me by the Holy Ghost. The teacher is here reminding me continually, and I'm listening to him. I'm waking up in the morning saying, Holy Ghost, speak to me. I'm just so blessed to have you in my life. You, what an amazing God. Lord, you're amazing. Do these things. Watch what will happen. Your life will change. In view of this, Paul says, who has delivered us from the power of darkness. And that means Satan has nothing on us. He has no hold on us. He can't stop you and me from moving forward in God. It's you and me that stop you and me from moving forward in God. The powers of darkness have no say in it. They got no say. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. can't say the devil. Devil, nothing. It's about time that you be, you know, I heard a woman preacher saying the other day, God has no place for sissies and cowards. I'm like, come on, bring it down. It's actually, it was Gloria Copeland. I'll say, praise God, somebody's got willing to stand up and say it's true. There's really no place for sissies and cowards. God has equipped us with his strength and his might and his power. If you're sissy and coward, somehow you missed out. You got in the wrong line. So now come over here tonight and get in the right line.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The line where you get endued with power from on high. Baby, you're going to steal the show. Are you going to minister some to us? I love you very much, but you're going to have to go sit down. I love carrying you around. I actually like that too. In fact, I know that Father loves it when we just refuse all other things. We cleave unto him. She's cleaving unto me. She's enjoying being right here. She smells of the bad praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Father, that Mama has taught Naomi how to praise. I thank you, Lord. Because Mama is going to have more impact on the children than Dad is ever going to have. She's the nurturer, and I praise God for a holy woman of God teaching these babies how to give themselves over to the Lord and flow in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Naomi, actually, in the Hebrew language, means the one who proclaims. She's gonna proclaim. And you know, somebody said, oh, that's a terrible name. Can't give them that name. Oh, that's old country, hillbilly name. That's a stick name. Naomi's a good name. It's a prophecy name, Naomi. Hallelujah. Koramasateya. And Anna over here. A holy woman of God who does signs and wonders and miracles. Who has the destiny of God upon her life in such a way. A double of it, as it were, of what Christ Jesus himself has. A double of that which is unlimited. And you can't say a double of that which is unlimited. Because that which is unlimited, you know, it's almost like wrong to say you have something greater. But he says greater. A greater works. I believe these things. I mean, I preach them. I'm going to preach them until somebody listens to them. I don't care how many sad and sorry looks I get. I don't care how much despondency I have to fight through. I don't know how much. It does not matter to me. Because I know that there is people who are going to honor me. And they're going to honor the word of God that's coming up out of my mouth. And suddenly, in the midst of that honor, they're going to recognize, ooh, that is the word of God. Because you're not going to see it. You're not going to see it. God retains all right to revelation. Suddenly, out of that honor, you're going to see. You're going to get a revelation. Wow. And you're going to be overwhelmed. And at that moment, you're going to receive the strength and the ability that God gives to anybody who's willing to do it his way. Hallelujah. And I'm set on it. I mean, I'm telling you, the Lord ministered to me the other night. He said, I got home. I was just like, you know, just, oh God, what will it take? And the Lord ministered to me out of Isaiah 61, talking to me about how that my seed would be famous in the earth and my descendants would be set on high in him. And I'm like, okay, Father, I'm going with that. He said, you just speak my word, you be faithful. Don't you regard what's going on. Don't you measure it. Don't you compare it. You just be faithful. You do what I've given you to do, and you say it. You say it as strong as I put it in your mouth, and I'll bless you for it. Because I'm telling you right now, with the force of this world, somebody's going to have to be shouting it down. Somebody's going to be have to be. There's going to have to be a greater force coming up from heaven, coming out of our lives. In the realms of the divine power to be able to deal with the force that's coming out of the determined will of Satan and the mind of iniquity. Hallelujah. We're not going to meet it with an equal force, but greater. Hallelujah. Kata bosheyaha. We guaranteed the victory. Hallelujah. We're not going to meet it with an equal force, but greater. I'm not going to stand around and watch this stuff go down. I'm personally touched by it. I'm personally moved in my inner being that I have a responsibility to rise up and do something about it and not close my eyes to people being murdered all around me, to all these things, to people's minds being polluted and indoctrinated with demon spiritual lies that God doesn't exist and that evil is better than righteousness. I'm not going to be silent. I'm going to jerk some stuff around. Father demands it of us. Lift up our voice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't see enough people posting a radical enough messages against sin and iniquity on their Facebook. I see too much, but I still see too many people showing off their food. Who cares about what's going in your stomach? It actually looks pretty ugly to me. And nothing pretty about that. I saw some two big old fat people with strawberry shortcake. It was like 8 inches of whipped cream. I thought, you people have no shame. You have no shame. I'm not kidding you. They were flopped. Their protoplasm was overflowing upon the table. The rolls of fat. And their big old strawberry shortcake. How do they pray over that? These are preachers. Jesus. People need to start getting stuff up on the Facebook. Get radical on the Facebook. I'm sick of hearing messages about whether or not you're going to have any money. I want to hear some messages about whether or not you're going to have any sin. Gain is not godliness. Having the authority to overcome iniquity is the proof. It's about time somebody starts crying out, hey, flee from the wrath to come, because it's coming. And not just to America, but I did appreciate that Facebook message today. I'm watching. I watch you guys. I got all of you. I've got you in my scope. I'm looking at your movements. I'm monitoring you.
Hallelujah.
We have a way to know every site that you visit on your computer. We know nothing evades the mind and the sight of the living God. We know what's going on. We in your business. You have no privacy. You naked before him with whom you have to do. There's nothing hidden. It's about time you become aware of it. And then begin to have a more sober response towards God. Hallelujah. Verse 16 says, For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. And then look right over here in chapter 2. And let's look at what he did. In verse 15. What he did when he gave his body as an offering for sin. What he did when he blotted out the handwritten writing of ordinances that were contrary to us and nailed them to the cross. He spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly. He triumphed over them in it. We look at Ephesians chapter 1, and you've heard me quote it so many times, but you're going to have to understand what it means. Here in verse 21 in Ephesians chapter 1, for he is far above all principalities. He's far above all power. He's far above all might and dominion. And every name that is in this world, not only in this world, but also in the world that is to come. And God has put all things under his feet and given him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all things. And you and I have been placed in a position with him. We've been raised up together with him to be seated in that same realm of divine authority. A spirit of wisdom and revelation is going to have to take hold of you so that you can understand what your inheritance is, what God did for you when he raised up Jesus from the dead. And then I hear people that begin to talk like and act like, well, because the Lord has done these things, then we're not going to face any interference, you know, all is well. I mean, there's not going to be any kind of struggle. I don't know what you're talking about, because you need to go ahead and finish reading the book. You need to just finish reading the chapter. But at least to finish reading the epistle, because then by the time you get to Ephesians chapter 6, he sets it up. This is where Christ Jesus is at. He sets it up. This is his authority. He begins to describe to us in chapter 3. He describes to us that we seated together with him in the heavenly realm. He makes it very clear that every sin, every trespass, every wrongdoing has been completely removed. That we have peace with God. We're brought nigh unto him. And then he brings us all the way to the place of Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10. He says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. He says, why? He says, take unto yourself, put on the whole armor of God, or take unto yourself the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle, not wrestle. It is a conflict of hand-to-hand grappling. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against rulers of the darkness. It's pretty intense. Somebody tell me about the Illuminati or the Third World Order or the, you know, League of whatever. Here it is, right here. This is the Luciferian cult. This is what's behind it. And you and I are supposed to shut it down. We're supposed to shut it down. Yeah. It's supposed to have no right of passage, no power to function or operate wherever we are at. We're supposed to be able to cast it out, tread upon it. We're supposed to have the ability to destroy the works of darkness. That is the assignment. The Lord said, I will be with you even unto the end of the world. I will be with you and in you. That's far better than Father saying to Joshua, as I was with Moses, so will I be with you. Why is it far better? Because he says he's going to take up his habitation on the inside of us. Now, he's not going to be talking to us. He's not going to be just talking to us. He's going to be talking through us. Because he's put his word in my mouth. It's not just the prophet declaring the words of God to the people who want to hear. It's God now that put his words in my mouth and in my heart. Hallelujah. I'm going to just tell you right now, if you don't believe God's put his word in my mouth, it just simply is a token that you don't believe he put his word in your mouth either. Huh? That's all that it is. You just don't have faith for the reality of the movings of the Spirit of God, the reality of the power and the presence of the and the authority of Christ Jesus in the midst of his church. So quit acting like that, okay? Quit acting like that. Don't depend upon your intellect because you're not that smart. I had to break the news to you. You're not that smart. But God the Holy Ghost will give you wisdom and understanding by his Spirit if you just simply obey. Just say, okay, Lord, I don't understand, but I'm going to obey you. And then in the obedience, he'll give you wisdom and understanding so that you'll so that you'll also know. Hallelujah. Father gives us the wisdom of the ages if we just get rid of whatever it is we got. Hallelujah. We quit depending upon our own intellect. He'll give us his intellect, his mind, his thinking, his understanding, his insight. But he's not going to run it, mix it with both. Because he's not going to let any man glory in his presence. And I praise him for that. He's not having a mixture, in other words. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, I thought tonight that I was going to really be able to get in to talking about the authority that the Lord has given to us as sons, and just take it to another level beyond what I took it this morning. They help us understand that in this authority of sons, it's lived out through relationship. It's lived out through an interaction with him. And I'm just going to just touch on it. I'm really not going to be able to, as it were, kind of do a replay on a lot of things that we established this morning, which I thought to do. but just to understand that the Lord has made us, he's given us sonship. He said in John 1:12, as many as would receive, he gave them the authority to be sons. And he's talking about the authority that he has. All authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Go in my name, do it. Make disciples out of nations. Wow. You're going to receive the promise of the Father. You're going to be endued with power from on high. God power, my power, the power of the Holy Spirit, so that you can be those who give proper witness and testimony to the authority of heaven. And in that context, I give you authority over all unclean spirits to cast them out. I give you authority to raise the dead. I give you authority to cast out devils, to lay hands on the sick, to speak with new tongues. No deadly thing will be able to touch you, harm you, hurt you. These works which I do, shall you do in greater works. Now, I'm telling you right now, that is taking a place, and that is being rooted and grounded and settled in the faith to say, I don't care what it looks like. I've been given this place in God, and I'm not going to be moved. And I'm going to stand here and speak to this mountain until it gets out of the way. I'm going to go ahead and move and command the dead to be raised to life again. I'm going to move in every dimension of faith. I'm not going to let up. I'm not going to let Satan shut me down from functioning in the joy and functioning in the pleasures of God at any moment, because if he shuts me down there, he's shutting me down everywhere. You must understand that. You're not walking in joy, you're not walking in the Holy Ghost. Period. So I said, isn't there like times we take breaks from that? No. Joy needs to be always there. Hallelujah. Needs to always be there. And the more you give yourself to that wonderful expression, the more you build yourself up in your most holy faith. The more that authority of God, that glory, that grace, that divine power and ability has effectiveness in our life and through our lives. And Paul says, you know, as I ministered to you over the past tonight in Romans chapter 8, actually over the past three nights in Romans chapter 8, that here the Holy Ghost bear witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if we're children, if we're walking in the sonship, then who are we? Then we heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. And he goes on to describe that all creation is groaning and travailing, looking and waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God to be touched by the glorious liberty of the sons of God, the children of God that he's talking about, that we already are and have a testimony and a description of faith that we are indeed those people. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. And so open. And then, of course, what Paul says, and to the church at Galatia, after setting everything up to the point that he did, beginning with Galatians 1:16, when he had the revelation that God purposed to reveal his son in him. Whew. That he then, in that state, went out and to a solitary place in Arabia so that the Lord for 3 years downloaded to him the revelation of the new covenant so that every one of us could also understand the Father's purpose to reveal his son in us. That the mystery of the fellowship might be made known through us. That the manifold wisdom of God might be demonstrated to the principalities and the powers, those authorities that we've read about and we've been talking about that are opposing the will of God, which Paul refers to in Ephesians 3:10, that I never turned you to that passage. That glorious declaration that he says that, and he describes when he declares to us that we have this sonship, and in this sonship, we heirs of God. We are functioning not as children, not with the faith to be servants, not with the faith to be a child, but the faith to be a son, walking in authority in the business of the living God. Hallelujah. Mambrum Jesse Kingdom Masate. Ha Shimanadeya. Ramamanaya Shipaya. Ramamanaya. And you know, when I begin to think about the sonship, I think about the relationship that the Son has, where Jesus said, I've always set the Father before me. I mean, I just so enjoy Father allowing himself to be revealed to me. A prophet, a man of God, said to me, he said, Father withholds the revelation of himself from people because men will take advantage of him. And I think it's far deeper than that, as now I've come to know Father more intimately. to be able to have the privilege of Father unveiling himself. Jesus has come to reveal the Father. The Holy Spirit has come to reveal Jesus and make him known. This interaction with the Holy Ghost, with the Lord Jesus Christ, is ultimately working out an intimacy with the Father so much that Jesus said, in that day you will not ask me anything. You'll ask the Father in my name and he'll do it for you. I'm handing you off to the Father, to the Papa God. The Spirit of the Son, the Spirit of Sonship, which is crying out on the inside of us, Dad, Abba, Father, God is my Father. And then all of the boldness and all the confidence and all the blessings that come therewith. You think I'm going to let this baby get tormented and be in sickness and disease? I'm telling you right now, I got a jealous, watchful eye. And the thing's got to get past her dad first, and that ain't going to happen. Because I'm second string. But I'm jumping in before anything, even before any strings are even mentioned. It just ain't going to happen. And you telling me that somehow Father is a less jealous, loving, protective Father? You don't know what you're talking about. You don't know what you're talking about. You've lived in things that are lies and deceptions, and I'm here to bust you out your prison. Because the word sets free. See, if you don't know the truth, you're going to live in bondage. And that's why I'm coming to you again and again and again, radically, boldly, boisterously, with truth. Why? Because I'm not interested in allowing you to go on living in some kind of prison and some kind of lie and some kind of deception. I hate the idea that somebody's walking around sick and diseased and poor as a representative of Jesus. Please don't tell nobody you know him. Till you get healed and fixed. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It's a false representation of who the people of the living God are. That's why I'm so provoked when people aren't joyous in the house of the Lord. Because it's a misrepresentation of what it means to know him, to be in his presence. And receive that which he supplies with his abundant life. It's a misrepresentation. It makes me angry to the very core of my being. It's a zeal that's eating me up. Ate Jesus up to consume him. In other words, you can actually use for that that's correct. Devours. It's a zeal that devours every other feeling, every other passion. Get out the house. My house should not be a house of merchandise, of misrepresentation. My house should be a house of praise, a house of thanksgiving. I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus feels the same way about it. I love you so much, baby. I know Jesus just being such a Holy Ghost girl here tonight, sitting and being a part of the whole thing. We got to work on Naomi. We got to work on her a bit. She's coming along. Hey, man. You just watch what she's going to be doing. Hey, man. I'm telling you right now. I pray that some of you get so excited about the Lord that the Holy Ghost will be able to set your feet a-dancing. And not just in the middle of one of the great songs, in the middle of just a joyous outburst of celebration over who he is. Ha. Hallelujah. Because the Spirit of the Son's more than bubbling up on the inside of you. It more than is an influence. It becomes a force. Hey, you know what? The Spirit of the Son may at first be an influence, may at first be an inspiration, but it's going to become an undeniable, irresistible force. Greater in its effect than thirst. Greater in its effect than hunger. Greater in its effect than sleep. Greater. And I'm telling you, as you allow these things to be nurtured and cultivated in your life, it's that kind of receptivity to God. It's that kind of yieldedness. It's that kind of participation that sickness and disease and sin does not have a chance. That poverty and oppression doesn't have a chance. The doubt, unbelief, and fear and all the other stuff that comes out of that realm doesn't have a chance. Because you're under the glory cloud. You're surrounded. You're surrounded by the hedge. Hallelujah. He's in you and with you. Praise God. You baptized down in him. Hallelujah. Arabastaya. And there are so many things to say about the sonship relationship. I'm just going to just mention a couple real quickly. There are certain things, of course, in John chapter 5, in the context of sonship, that we never would say of ourselves independently. In fact, I want you to say and understand there's none of these things that we would say of ourselves independently. We have all of this because we exist in Him. And it's so hard for me seemingly to get this message across that we don't exist outside of Him. He's all of our life. He's all of our being, our existence, our righteousness, our holiness. We find our whole meaning and value and purpose in Him. But when we listen to some of these things concerning the relationship that He's already highlighted as being, or rather is going to highlight rather in a greater way as being those evidence that exemplify our walk with Father, our obedience to Him, as is described in John chapter 14, when He says to us, these works shall we do in greater works. We know that these things that we're saying here, like in verse 22, is also certainly speaking of who we are and what God has purposed to do through us, how He's a purpose to interact with us. And so verse 19 is where I wanted to take us, rather. He says, with absolute certainty, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of Himself. And that's just it. You know, Jesus said in John 15:5, you can do nothing without me. This is a place where we begin to lock into an interaction with Father, a place that is only going to be revealed to you because you build an altar, because you're being willing to be continually baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You're being willing to allow the Holy Ghost to overwhelm you and to capture your attention more than anything else. All of a sudden, these things begin to stir your passion. You know, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me today something that you need to listen to. See, listen, if husbands and wives, if you're not on the same page yet, you need to pray separately until you grow and mature to get on the same page. Otherwise, it's not going to work out. It's a blessed thing when you get on the same page, and I hope you get on the same page quickly. But if you're not on the same page, if you're not going after the same kind of passion, pray separately. Go different places. And then come together and pray and agree and move in whatever it is that you both can move and agree in. But don't get, watch out, because you can get just bogged down. Huh? I mean, it should be both, where you pray together and you pray separately, because there's always that ongoing. But listen, you listen to me. I'm talking about you building an altar where the glory of God comes on you in a way that is evidenced in your life, to where that Father can now begin to interact with you and reveal things to you. Baby, you just had the Holy Ghost. What happened? You're just walking in the peace. What took place? The joy has... Sweetheart, listen. Just wait a minute. Hold up just one sec. Listen. This is very good. Father wants to come reveal Himself to Anna. But He's not going to force Himself. He's going to force entry. He's going to come as a response of our obedience. He's going to come as a response to the love we've allowed the Holy Spirit to flood our souls with. And we enjoy that love. And so we want to stay in that love. And we want to participate with that love. Oh, God. Jesus says, here's the sonship. He says, with absolute certainty, I tell you, the Son can do nothing of Himself but what He sees the Father do. For what things soever the Father does, so the Son does likewise. Come on now. There is a place of relationship, dear people. Verse 30, I can have on my own self do nothing. See, it's just such an example for us. Anna, hey, I'd like to talk to some of you like that. I'm just being honest. Because I can feel exactly the same way about it. You're not saying nothing. It has something to do with things that are going on silently. And I pray that you'll be so open to God and so yielded to Him that I'll have the liberty to talk to you like that. Amen. Because there's that kind of love relationship going down. But if you don't have that kind of love relationship with the Father, how can you have that love relationship with a servant of the Lord? Huh? In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We're trying to help Anna understand that she's under authority. She doesn't believe that yet. But if we don't teach her that she's under authority now, she's never going to learn, or it's going to be a hard course for her to learn. She'll never understand how to be under the authority of the Holy Ghost. She'll never learn, because God's primary government, the place where God executes more training than any other place in our life, is what happens to the father and the mother in the family. And it's a terrible thing when it's ungodly. It's a terrible thing when it's false models, when it isn't what God designed. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I'm going to take the time. Just take the time. Church is about seeing people come under the wonderful rule of heaven. Because it's not something evil. It's not something bad. It's life. It's preservation. Hallelujah. It's every good thing. And I found that praying over the children actually do more than spanking can do. Huh? And you say, well, they've been sitting in the church so long. So, what? Give them some electronics and they'll sit there and stare at that thing for a long time. Amen. Let's just join hands here and let's have a prayer meeting. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody wants me to hold them. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody stand with me.